Project.
Simply in time, we're here, we're live.
Hello, I'm MJL Tudor Dumont. Welcome to Simply Mjad. We're here at the lovely center of George William Enterprises to have an amazing conversation with a dear friend that I label JR, Mr. Jean Robert Lafortune. And we're going to have a great conversation with him today. And how are you, JR?
I would say I'm doing okay now. But in life, you know, it's a dream. I have good days and bad days. But I'm very
How's the family? Everybody's okay. We're gonna get to conversation. We've interviewed before. We've had a conversation before.
Yeah.
And talk show involved. We're having conversation. And one of the questions that I want to have is you've been speaking about the situation of Dominican Republic way before it became this global. You've been on this. And on this issue, can you give us an overview of what has been happening, your thoughts?
Okay, so basically, the first time I went to the Dominican Republic, it was in 2007, when the colonization of American State was in there for the advance. And I was able to basically address the assembly and bring to them kind of injustice that Haitians, say migrants and Haitian residents were facing. I was able to catalog about 1,000 cases whereby the Dominicans had addressed, they had the fault and the Haitians and all of those 12 cases, there has been no police report, no investigation. I told the state at that time, I said, because he was the foreign minister, that is a bad way to do business.
That is
something
bad.
Yes,
yes. As an advocate, you can't just sit back and watch this.
That's how it is. These kind of things, so,
for the way. Can't tolerate that. What's going on with humanity in this case?
Yes, and for instance, when we take the situation right now in Europe, you can see that a few thousand of refugees decided to walk from Syria all the way to Germany in order to seek relief, to seek protection.
See, what I like about you, it's about people. Not just patients, but about people.
That's
the humanitarian year. That's what I want to talk about.
That is correct, yes. I hope it for all people.
Yes.
Yes, I want to say the situation on Syria. It is mind boggling to see children. In fact, one of them was in his head.
Yes.
Doing that trip. It takes 30 days to walk from bushes to bushes, from country to country, in order to make it over there. And now, there is also some enemies to them because not all countries are willing to open the door to them. The people are hungry, the bureaucracy, Slovakia.
Why is that? Why no one is willing to assist?
We cannot say no one. I believe that in countries like Germany, they are hoping to receive to accept them. People countries like Hungary, they are accepting them, but there are some few countries parallel to them.
That's saying no, we cannot have you.
People like Hungary, people like Slovakia, and the other smaller countries, basically saying no to those refugees.
Have they stated as to why they don't want to assist?
Anyway, when I believe that there are people that were because just using bigotry in order to save your human life. And if you years ago, you were in a bad situation. Because Hungary is not the country that has been always peaceful. They have had the civil war, fight the German and make it, and get into conflicts where the population will think themselves. And when we see that situation, we can see the humanity of the European people, but here in the Caribbean,
where
there is a big crisis that's going on. And that crisis is generated by the United States. By the United States in the sense that...
There are people that are pretty much, a lot of them there, I would say that they're missing in action because they don't have a home, even the children that are born there. They don't know who they are. They deported them. They go back to Haiti, a place that they never know. They have nobody. And then the actual country where they're supposed to be citizens are do not want them. So they are displaced.
In the case of Dominican Republic, there are solutions. There are solutions in the sense that if Haiti could declare a state of emergency in ceremony, and in order to encourage the international community to intervene, and ask the United Nations that those people that were born in the Dominican Republic, there are provisions in the law of the UN where Haiti can grant them.
So Haiti is a country as well?
Yes, refugee status. Because once they are going to take refugee status, so that relieve them of the pressure of finding a way somewhere in Haiti to survive. And all of them did not even know how to navigate in Salvador. The report that I received shows that many of them they are basically suffering from things like hunger. They put them in a place in camps where there is no water. They put them in camps where there is no way to do the thing. It's a bad situation.
What's my God thing for me, in my mind, is that my father destroys the children, and I left Haiti at the age of 9, but I went to school and I studied before I left. It's one country. Why not this separation? Why is so much the physical difference? Where, why do you think so? What do you think?
I believe that we have When we talk about Haiti, we have to look in the perspective of two countries. We have a country where people are Yemeni, the elites, who are not, who lack nothing to survive.
Yemeni, by the way, is people just living life.
Yeah,
people the higher end of life.
The good
life.
They have nice house.
My father always told me it was 80-20. And I remember I didn't understand that. And he would say, MJ, just because you're part of the 20%, you must serve, because the 80% meaning of people that are suffering that they have much, which is a very, very large amount.
Yes, in fact that situation is much worse now than the time that your father was talking to me. As I was saying, we have two kind of Haiti. We have Haiti of the good life. And also we have the real Haiti, that's what I call the real Haiti, the Haiti of the poor. The Haiti of the poor is one where you have the majority of the population living in bare misery. They are living on a day-to-day, they are living on in a way that is not fit for human habitation. In a way, we're schooling very hard.
Education,
really hard.
And education is part of growth?
Oh yes, definitely. In fact, education is the key to break the barriers of poverty. And when you see that the population is suffering, because it's being abused by the people who hold the reign of power, that's making it very, very, very sad. And also this is also that causing frustration inside the whole body when we see that.
What leads to separation as well?
Yes. And when we go to smaller countries like the Bahamas, we go to the islands. There is nothing special those countries can do, and we ourselves cannot do in Haiti.
Hold that thought. We'll take a break. We'll be right back to continue our conversation with Jerome, Mr. Lafortune. Wow. Welcome back to our conversation with Mr. Lafortune. And we had an amazing conversation on various topics. As for you that have been watching, previously that there's so much that we'll be touching today. And can you tell us a little bit about your organization?
Patient nationality,
I know you took a stand for TPS.
Yes.
A couple years ago.
Yes.
With President Obama. You've gone to talk to President, past President Bush.
He went in shock and killed himself. So those are the kind of
I had a classmate. Similar things has happened, and we want to end it there because it's so emotional for me. He had a girlfriend. With the last name, I won't even say on air, but the last name, he just couldn't hide under that last name. Okay. So it was one of those, you know, you're either Haitian or you're French. So someone had to know he was Haitian. And then his mom saw him, and she spoke with him on the street. The girl was with him. He shot himself. So I do know. And yeah, that's it for me. Well, I want to
So
say,
luckily, we have a much better connection now.
Yeah.
Well,
when I see things that say I'm Haitian 100% and made in Haiti, I'm like, okay, all right. Because back then, you know, when I was young, people thought I was crazy. But I kept telling them, I say, some days, you know, we want to be the ones on the VH1, we want to have the clothesline, we want to be the record.
Yes,
they say we're crazy. But
there is
I know.
Much more to be done because
we're amazing people.
Yeah,
we're amazing people.
Because we the leaders of the community, we have a responsibility to teach the youngsters the history of our country. Because
parents are responsible as well.
Parents are responsible as well. And so far, the story of Haiti has been told by the white men.
So I think it's time that we need to tell it ourselves.
That is
not that we have a problem with it because we believe in uniting, but we must tell our own stories.
We must as well have the responsibility to share our own stories.
I gotta come back and talk to you some more because this show, you know, is half an hour. But I have something that I like to, you know, my fave people, I like to present you. It's a little humble.
Oh, look.
Yeah. So
that's nice.
Yeah, and it's so difficult to get a photograph of you where I can write something. Okay.
But you live in a big job in here.
That's thanks to producers for that. You know, I write the letter with the ad on everything.
I know that.
Could you read it for us, please?
Okay. I don't see that. It says that the diaspora was on the TV and the labor, he carries them well to the full. For his in your work. While you are at it, please do not forget humanitarian causes. Yes, we are joyfully having a conversation about Mr. Jean Robert Lafortune, who I label JR. He is one who is full of compassion and passion about what can be labeled with people for he has taken a stand in the Haitian diaspora. However, the truth is, he is passionate and practices compassion toward other people and works very well in a hat, by the way. That's what I'm talking about.
Love that.
Yes, a composition of transformation by MZ and Tibor at the Mall in 2007. Fly like an eagle production. And merci un peu.
Okay, we've come to the end of our show, and we want to thank you for watching. And then one of the things I like to say is that take a stand in the world. And you know what they say, one life you save the entire world, because you really truly don't know who you're saving and how that person's going to make a difference. So take a stand for yourself, take a stand for your neighbors as well. And your neighbors is really not just the person next door, it's the people in the world. Until next time, you know, take care of yourself and one another, and love. See you next time on Simply Mjad. Wow.